Thank you, Pastor. It is such a thrill to be able to share in your missions conference. I would like to pause briefly before I get into the message tonight to ask you to join me in prayer. Today I received an email from China. My dear friend Ken Lawman, who is a BIMI missionary in Beijing, China, God has blessed in his ministry there in amazing ways. I've had the joy of working with him for the last 6 or 7 years as God has blessed. They have a church auditorium that they have redesigned and remodeled. It's rented, of course, because you can't own land in the land of China. But they have a congregation of nearly 200 people. They're right there in the middle of Beijing, China. They have a Christian school where they're actually using the Abeka program to have a Christian school for Chinese children. And this is a great way to reach the Chinese with the gospel of Jesus Christ as well. They have a Bible Institute type of a program. They have a full evangelistic program. They've started 3 other churches in China there. But today, for their Sunday service, the police came in to their auditorium and forced the people to return home and took Brother Ken Lawman in for questioning to the police department. They have not closed them down yet, but they don't know for sure what is facing them in the days ahead. So I think it would be good if we would just pause and ask God to intervene, and that God would allow them. They've seen so many people come to know Christ. They've seen so much done for the glory of God there in that dark land of China. And we need to pray with them because persecution is real. It's happening. There is perhaps more persecution against Christians today than we have ever had in history. But when it hits home like this, and it's someone you know who is probably right now still sitting in the police station answering the questions that they have for him to answer as to why he's meeting and what they're doing and all of those things. God can intervene as he did in the book of Acts, and we need to pray that. So as we're having our missions conference, let's pause. Paul said there in 2 Corinthians, I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning the troubles that came on us in Asia and how God intervened, you also helping together by prayer for us. So, Pastor, if it's okay with you, I'd like to just briefly pray for Brother Ken Lawman, his family there. His son is on his way back to join him as a missionary there, and it's exciting what God is doing. Father, we don't understand why so many of these things happen in this world when you are doing a marvelous work reaching the hearts of men, women, boys and girls who are perishing in dark lands like China. Peoples who are in total rebellion against you, against your purposes, and against anything that would glorify your name. And yet, Lord, we do know there are those who, at risk of their own safety, their own life, they're willing to go and to minister and to take the risks that they must take in order to get the gospel to perishing people. Lord, how we pray that you would intervene and that you would give many more years of ministry there. That you would, Lord, speak to the hearts of those who are in rebellion against you and against your people and against your ministry. And Lord, we will praise you if you will do this for the Lawman missionary family and all the other missionaries who work with them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Turn with me, please, to 2 Peter. The Lord has spoken to my heart. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And yet, all over this planet, millions have never one time heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they are perishing in their sin. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, we read these words, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And yet, everywhere, men, women, boys, and girls are perishing in their sin. I think of the old hymn that Fanny Crosby wrote, "Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep o'er the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Though they are slighting him, still he is waiting, waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with them in earnestly, plead with them gently. He will forgive if they only believe. Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, feelings lie buried that grace can restore. Touched by a human heart, touched by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, chords that are broken can vibrate once more. Rescue the perishing. Duty demands it. Strength for thy labor the Lord will provide. Back to the narrow way, patiently win them. Tell the poor wanderer a Savior has died." You see, the task of the Church of Jesus Christ is to rescue the perishing. Right, right. Satan is seeking to keep the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ from shining to perishing peoples all over this world. But we need to hear the pleas, the prayers, the pleadings that come to us for perishing people all over planet Earth. A very simple thought in the message this evening as we approach our missions conference. You see, lost people, if they do not hear the gospel, will die in their sins. I want you to open, the scripture says, "He that has ears to hear, let him hear." And I would beg with you, plead with you, to hear with your spiritual ears the pleadings, the pleas that come to us from perishing people, so that we might desire to do more in getting the gospel out, to do more to grow in our missionary giving, to be able to send out more missionaries, to be willing to go to more people ourselves so that they need not perish in their sins. It is not God's will that even one should perish. We need to be active in rescuing the perishing. And then if we will listen, take your Bibles and turn with me, please, to Ezekiel. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 33. And I want you to hear, first of all, the plea that comes to you for perishing peoples from the portals of heaven. God says in Ezekiel 33, verse 7, "So thou, O son of man, I have set thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore thou shalt hear the word of my mouth and warn them from me. When I say unto the wicked, O wicked man, thou shalt surely die, if thou dost not speak to warn the wicked man from his way, that wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thy hand. Nevertheless, if thou warn the wicked of his way to turn from it, if he do not turn from his way, he shall die in his iniquity, but thou hast delivered thy soul. Therefore, O son of man, speak unto the house of Israel, thus ye speak, saying, if our transgressions and our sins be upon us, and we pine away in them, how shall we then live? Say unto them," now this is the voice of Almighty God, as he says to his prophet, "Say unto them, as I live, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked man turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways, for why will ye die, O house of Israel?" You see, it is not the will of God the Father that even one person perish in their sins. And here we can hear his voice as he says, "Warn them for me. Send them the message." Someone needs to go to perishing people all over this world, taking the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, so that none be able to say, "I never heard one time the gospel of Jesus Christ." The gospel is such a marvelous message. I have seen it over and over and over again. It is exciting to me when I go into a place and go in and people who have never heard the gospel, who are in rebellion against God, who are in deep idolatry and false religion, they hear the gospel. And as I'm preaching, not because it's me, but it's because of the message that is being preached. And I can see as they look at me in angry faces, and as they look at what, as I'm trying to talk to them, sometimes I'm able to speak in Japanese. Other times when I'm in countries where that speak different languages, I have to speak through an interpreter. But I can see them as they look with those angry eyes, and they have those looks of doubt. And then all at once, I'll see a glimmer in an eye, as if they're recognizing, "Oh, there may be something in this. What I'm hearing sounds true." And then they have the choice of believing and receiving or denying and rejecting. But they do have a choice. And God the Father, from the portals of heaven, is saying to us, I want you to warn them for me. If they die in their iniquity, they will die in their sins and they will perish. But if they do not be warned, their blood will be upon your hands. You remember the story of Pilate when he condemned Jesus Christ to die on the cross, and he had them bring out that basin of water and tried to wash away the guilt of the blood of Jesus Christ. He couldn't wash it away. But there may be a time in judgment when we who have refused to do what the Lord God has commanded us to do, to warn the wicked of their sins so that they need not perish in their sins, their blood will be required at our hands. But it does say that if we warn them, even when they deny and reject the gospel and die in their iniquity, that we will be free from the blood of those people. We will have done what we have been commanded to do when he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. The plea that comes from the portals of heaven, warn them for me. Warn them for me. We need to hear that plea. Now I want you to turn with me, please, to the book of Luke. I want you to hear the plea that comes in the book of Luke. This is the plea that comes from the pits of hell. In Luke chapter 16, a passage of scripture that I do not like to preach from, but it's necessary. Luke chapter 16. Verse 19, we read these words. I'm sorry. Luke 16, verse 9. My eyes are failing me. Luke 16 and verse 9. I'm having problems here. 16:19. I was right the first time. Okay? I should have known that I couldn't make a mistake. I tell my grandchildren, and I have 12 of them, now your granddaddy is not always right, but he's never wrong. Of course, you know that's not true. But there was a certain rich man, verse 19, which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeing Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thou good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from thence to you cannot, and neither can they that would pass and come from thence to you. Then he said, I pray thee, Father Abraham, that would send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this awful place. I submit to you that we are listening to a plea that's coming from the pits of hell for God to send somebody to tell his lost brothers about Jesus Christ and about the gospel. This is the plea that comes from the pits of hell. In Japan, they worship their own dead ancestors, their grandparents, their parents, and they become objects of worship and objects of fear. And so many times when I'm witnessing to Japanese people, they will say, oh, I think the Christian message is a wonderful message. I love to hear about the love of Jesus. I would love to be a Christian, but I am so afraid of what my parents or my grandparents would do. And over, I have turned to this passage of Scripture. And I've said, if you have loved ones in hell, they don't want you to come there. They are pleading that God would send somebody to you to give you the message of the love of God and the forgiveness of God, and the opportunity of receiving everlasting life in heaven. And maybe that's why I'm here. Maybe God is answering their prayer from hell and has sent me to give you the gospel. The plea that comes from the pits of hell. Those who are already in hell do not want their loved ones to join them there. They don't want them to come to that awful place. Can't you hear the plea that comes from the pitiful heathen? The plea that comes from the pit, first of all, the plea that comes from the portals of heaven, then the plea that comes from the pits of hell. I have loved ones that, as far as I know, they're in hell right now. But they don't desire other people to come there. They want us as the Church of Jesus Christ to be faithful in our faith promise giving, be faithful in our prayers, be faithful in our door-to-door witnessing, to be faithful in getting the gospel out so that their loved ones will not join them in the pits of hell. Can you hear the plea that comes from the portals of heaven? Can you hear the plea that comes from the pits of hell? Now turn to the book of Acts, chapter 16, and I'll try to get it right this time. The book of Acts, chapter 16. Beginning in verse 6, it says, now when they, that's Paul and Silas and the missionaries, had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. After they were come to Mysia, they essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. You know, I don't understand, but God does lead specific people to go to specific places. I know beyond any shadow of doubt. This passage of Scripture right here was used by God, the Holy Spirit, when it says here that they were forbidden by the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. The same Holy Spirit spoke to my heart in my dormitory room at Tennessee Temple College and said, "But you are not forbidden. That's exactly where I want you to go." And I knew that. And I've known that for 51 plus years, that God's specific place for me was in the land of Japan. Now, I don't understand. People ask you to explain why, and you can't. We've got a man here that says God has called him to Quebec. I would venture to say there's no place in this Bible that you can point me to that says you are to go to Quebec. But I guarantee you that God the Holy Spirit used this Bible to lead you to Quebec. Because God the Holy Spirit, who is the author of the Word of God, can be personal in His leadership. And here's Paul. He's eager. And it's better to try to go somewhere than to go nowhere. You know, we don't need to sit around and wait for a flash of lightning from heaven to tell us that we're supposed to be a missionary. If we say, "Lord, here am I, send me," I can almost guarantee you that He'll send you somewhere. He won't say, "No, thank you, I don't need you." But here Paul was seeking to go in a direction that God did not want him to go. I don't know why. I don't know why the Lord didn't want him to go that way. But then the night came. And in verse 9 it says, "A vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, 'Come over to Macedonia and help us.' And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them." You see, when God speaks to the heart of a leader, then He also calls the team to go with him. And many times, a part of that team is the supporting and sending church. And when God calls a man to go, then that's when you begin to pray, "Lord, would you have us to support this missionary? Would you have us to go to that place that you've called him to go?" And that's how you cannot. Pastor Love, you cannot support every missionary that contacts you here at Bensalem Baptist Church. But you can support every missionary that God wants you to support here at Bensalem Baptist Church. But what you need to do is, as you hear the plea that comes from the portals of heaven, and as you are sensitive even to that plea that comes from the pits of hell, you also need to be sensitive through your missions conferences and your mission speakers and the missionary news that you get. You need to be sensitive to the plea that comes from the pitiful heathen all over this world. And you need to say, "God would have us to be involved in that ministry." "Come over and help us. Oh, please hear our cry. There's no one to tell us, and soon we will die. Come over and help us. We're lost in the night. We're groping in darkness. Oh, please send the light. Come over and help us before it's too late. We need to know Jesus. How long must we wait? Come over and help us. Oh, please hear our plea. We're bound in sin's shackles. We long to be free. Come over and help us. We're trapped in our fear. How can we believe if we can't even hear? We're helpless and hopeless. No one seems to care. Come over and help us. Oh, please hear our prayer." You see, that's what missions conference is all about. I'm here, of course, representing the Savior. But I'm also here representing lost, dying, perishing people all over this world. And God so loves this world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God doesn't want even one to perish, which means He wants all to hear the gospel. Amen. That's why He said, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." That's why He said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." Did you ever realize that what that means is that every individual human being is an individual creation of God? Oh yes, the body comes from the parents and all the way from Adam with the sinful nature. But the spirit and the soul is an individual creation of God. And God does not want even one of those to perish. That's why He says, if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. We must get the gospel message to the world. People are perishing. People all over the world are perishing. The people across the road, people on your block, people who work in the same place you work, are perishing in their sins. And God does not want even one of them to perish. So He wants us to be faithful. So when we pray about our giving and our going and what we are doing as a church for the cause of Christ and missions around this world, we need to be sensitive and listen with the ear of faith to the plea that comes from the portals of heaven for perishing people, to the plea that comes from the pits of hell for perishing people, and to the plea that comes from the pitiful heathen all over this world, that we would send the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. Oh, can't you hear the plea that comes from heaven above? Oh, can't you hear His voice? Oh, can't you feel His love? He has purpose for your life. He has a perfect plan. He sends you with gospel light to make them understand. Oh, can't you hear the plea that comes from hell below? Send someone to tell the lost that they the truth may know. This torment is my fate. I can't be saved by grace. But let my loved ones hear. Don't send them to this place. Oh, can't you hear the plea from heaven, from heathen far and near? Please help us, is their cry. We're bound in sin and fear. If someone isn't sent, then they will never know. Someone must hear their cry. Does He want you to go? Oh, look into your heart and find compassion there. Will you not heed the call? Will you the gospel share? From heaven and from hell and from the heathen too, these pleas tug at your heart. What are you going to do? Let's stand together for prayer as the pastor comes to close the service.